In this class, we are going to discuss about the role of a lexical analyzer. In this concept, we will discuss about the first one, lexical analyzer functions. Lexical analyzer functions, or we can also call it as role of lexical analyzer. So second topic, separation of lexical analyzer from syntax analyzer. So third one about tokens, lexemes and patterns. Next, fourth one about lexical errors. So in the role of lexical analyzer topic, we will discuss all these topics. So the first one is lexical analyzer functions, or the role of lexical analyzer. The second one is separation of lexical analyzer from syntax analyzer. Lexical analyzer can also be called as scanner, whereas syntax analyzer can also be called as parser. And the third one is tokens, lexemes and patterns. And the fourth topic is lexical errors. So all these four topics will be discussed in the role of lexical analyzer. So let's see the first task of the lexical analyzer. Lexical analyzer reads the source program character by character and produces a stream of tokens. So here the first task of lexical analyzer is it produces a stream of tokens. So what is a token? Token may be either a variable name, that is identifier, or a constant, or a keyword, or an operator. It may be arithmetic operator, or relational operator, or logical operator, or some dot operator, or semicolon, or comma, any operator. And the second function of the lexical analyzer is it removes comments from the source program. So we know that comments are mainly useful for understanding purpose. So the comments never compiled, as well as the comments never executed. So the lexical analyzer removes the comments from the source program. And the next task of the lexical analyzer is it removes white space characters such as, we have several white space characters like blank space character, comma, tab space character, and new line characters. So lexical analyzer removes the white space characters such as blank space, tab space, and new line characters from the source program. Why? Because if you take a C program or C++ or Java program, we can write all the statements in a single line, like hash include, let the first statement is hash include stdio.h, hash include stdio.h, next main function, main left parenthesis, right parenthesis, next left curly brace, next int space a, semicolon. So likewise, we can write all the statements in a single line. So here the lexical analyzer removes the blank space character. Blank space means a single space. Let us assume that a variable is declared like this. So into space a comma b semicolon. If there is only one blank space, then there is no problem. Let we have four blank spaces, into space a comma b semicolon. Now these four blank spaces will be removed with the help of lexical analyzer. So lexical analyzer removes a single blank space, or tab space means it gives 2 to 3 spaces or 3 to 4 spaces. That depends upon the corresponding compiler. And it also removes new line characters, okay, from the source program. And the next advantage of the lexical analyzer is it counts line numbers. It counts line numbers of source program. Why? Because here the task of lexical analyzer is, lexical analyzer reads the source program character by character. If the program contains 100 lines, then the lexical analyzer has to read the corresponding 100 lines. So it has to know how many number of lines are present in the source program. So that should be done with the help of the lexical analyzer. It counts the line numbers of the source program, the number of lines. And the next task of the lexical analyzer is, it generates a symbol table. It generates a symbol table which stores information about identifiers. Which stores information about identifiers. So we know that the task of lexical analyzer is, it reads the source program character by character and produces a token. So whenever a token is generated, then lexical analyzer stores token information in the symbol table. So the symbol table stores information about the identifiers. So that symbol table generation is done by lexical analyzer. And the next task of the lexical analyzer is, it provides error messages with corresponding line numbers and column numbers. With corresponding line numbers and column numbers. So it provides error messages with the corresponding line numbers and the column numbers. Generally, we know that whenever an error occurred during compilation process, then error handler will comes into the picture, and error handler reports error messages to the user. But here the lexical analyzer provides those error messages with corresponding line numbers and column numbers to the error handler. Now error handler reports those error messages to the user. So actually error messages reporting is done by the error handler only. But to error handler, the lexical analyzer will provides error messages with corresponding line numbers and column numbers. So this is about the first subtopic, lexical analyzer functions or the role of lexical analyzer. Next we have one more point here. That is nothing but interaction between lexical analyzer and syntax analyzer. The other name for lexical analyzer is scanner, whereas the other name for syntax analyzer is parser. Here lexical analyzer accepts a source program as the input. Lexical analyzer accepts a source program as the input and produces a token, and the token information is passed to the next page of the compiler. So the next phase of the compiler is syntax analyzer. And after passing the token to the syntax analyzer, it generates a symbol table. Symbol table stores information about the identifiers, such as what is the name of the identifier, what is the value of the identifier, what is the scope of the identifier, whether it is local scope or global scope. That information is specified here. Then after that, after receiving the token, syntax analyzer sends a request to the lexical analyzer for the next token. So it requests for, syntax analyzer request for other token. And here syntax analyzer also interacts with symbol table in order to receive information about the identifiers, whether the identifier syntax is correct or not. So in order to know the information about the identifiers, the syntax analyzer also interacts with symbol table. So here what is happening? Lexical analyzer receives source program as the input and produces a token and passes the token to the syntax analyzer. And after that, syntax analyzer receives the token and sends a request to the lexical analyzer for the other token. Here, once the token is generated, lexical analyzer stores token information in the symbol table. Okay. Syntax analyzer also interacts with symbol table in order to know information about the identifiers. Then after that, what will happen? Lexical analyzer will check whether the syntax of the corresponding tokens is correct or not. If the syntax is correct, then it generates a parse tree. That parse tree is passed to the next phase of the lexical analyzer. The next phase of the lexical analyzer is semantic analyzer. So it produces parse tree. So parse tree is passed to the what is the next phase? Semantic analyzer. So in this way, the interaction is done between the lexical analyzer and syntax analyzer. Now let's see the next subtopic. So what is the next subtopic? The separation of lexical analyzer from syntax analyzer. So next subtopic in the role of lexical analyzer, that is second topic, separation of lexical analyzer from syntax analyzer . There are mainly three reasons why the lexical analyzer is separated from the syntax analyzer. The first reason is to simplify the design of a compiler. Next one, to increase the efficiency of compiler. Third one, to enhance the portability of a compiler. So these are the three main reasons regarding why the lexical analyzer is separated from the syntax analyzer. So the first one, to simplify the design of a compiler. Second one, to increase the efficiency of a compiler. Third one, to enhance the portability of a compiler. Now let's see the first one. So what is the first one? To simplify the design of a compiler. If we separate lexical analyzer from syntax analyzer, then lexical analyzer will do its own tasks, such as it reads the source program character by character and produces a stream of tokens. And the syntax analyzer will do its own tasks, such as it checks whether the token syntax is correct or not. If the syntaxes are correct, then it generates the parse tree. So there is no burden on the single page. Whereas if we combine these two pages in a single page, then the burden on the single, then the burden on a single page will increase. So in order to reduce the burden on a single page, we will separate those two pages. So lexical analyzer will do its own tasks, syntax analyzer will do its own tasks. Now the design of a compiler is simplified. Why? Because each page can do its own task. And the second reason is to increase the efficiency of the compiler. Here in lexical analyzer we use regular expressions. So regular expressions are mainly useful in order to represent the tokens in some lexical analyzer. That we know that the regular expressions are recognized with the help of finite automata. So lexical analyzer is recognized with the help of finite automata, whereas the syntax analyzer is nothing but context free grammar. So context free grammar generates parse tree. We know that the context free grammar is recognized with the help of push down automata. So syntax analyzer is recognized with the help of push down automata. In push down automata we use a stack. We know that push down automata is very very complex than finite automata. If we combine those two, then what will happen is the push down automata has to read the source program and it has to produce a stream of tokens. So in order to produce a single token, the push down automata will take more amount of time, because that information has to be stored in the stack. So what will happen now? The efficiency of the compiler will reduces if we combine those two pages. Why? Because the push down automata has to read the source program. So the burden on the compiler will increase. So for that purpose, if you want to increase the efficiency of the compiler, then it is very very compulsory to separate lexical analyzer from the syntax analyzer. Now let's see the third reason. The third reason is to enhance the portability of the compiler. We know what is portability. So portability means working on several platforms. So if you separate lexical analyzer from the syntax analyzer base, then the portability of the compiler will be increases. So this is about separation of lexical analyzer from syntax analyzer. So with this two topics are over in the role of lexical analyzer. The first one is lexical analyzer functions. The second one is separation of lexical analyzer from syntax analyzer. Now let's see the third one. So here the third one is about tokens, lexemes and patterns. First let's see about what is a token. A token is a pair. Token is a pair which consists of two components. The first component is token name, comma, the second component is attribute value. So a token is a pair which consists of two components. The first component is token name, whereas the second component is attribute value. The token name may be an identifier, that is nothing but variable, or an operator, or a keyword, or a constant. And the next one is attribute value. The attribute value is a pointer which points to an entry of the symbol table for token information. With the help of an example, we will discuss later. So that is about token information. So how to define a token? A token can be defined with the help of a pair, a single pair, which consists of two components. Token name, attribute value. So token name may be identifier, that is nothing but variable, or operator, or a constant, or a keyword. And what is attribute value? Attribute value is an entry which points to symbol table for token information. And the next one is lexeme. Lexeme means a sequence of characters. So how to define a lexeme? Lexeme means a sequence of characters. Now let us take an example. let here the example is E is equal to mc square, energy formula. So E is equal to m into c square. Here c square means c power 2. That power operator is nothing but exponential operator. So E is equal to m into c square. So this star star is known as exponentiation operator. C square can be written as c star star 2 semicolon. So now let's see what are the lexemes and tokens in these examples. So lexeme, token. So what is lexeme? A sequence of characters. What is the first character here? E. So E is a lexeme. Next is equal to is a lexeme. Next M is a lexeme. Next C is a lexeme. Next exponentiation operator. Star star is a lexeme. Next 2 is a lexeme. Next semicolon is a lexeme. Next, what is the token for E? So how to represent token? Token name comma attribute value. Token name comma attribute value. So here what is E? E means identifier. So within the angular brackets, ID comma attribute value. Attribute value is a pointer. Let the pointer here is 1. Which points to an entry in the symbol table for token information. So ID comma 1. So this can also be written as RID 1. Now what will happen is a symbol table will be generated. So this is the symbol table. So symbol table stores information about the identifiers. So what is the attribute value here? So this is the attribute value. Next, what is the name here? Name of the identifier is ID. And here we have other informations like what is the value of the identifier. Next, what is the scope of the identifier, whether it is local variable or global variable, everything will be stored there. So here this is nothing but attribute value. So it is an entry which points to the symbol table for token information. So if you want to get information about ID, then we have to use this attribute value. And what is the next one? Is equal to. Is equal to is nothing but an assignment operator. Is equal to is nothing but an assignment operator. So what is the token here? What is the token here? Is equal to is the token. Here for operators and constants, there is no need of any attribute value. Only for identifiers, attribute value is necessary. Because we have several attributes, several identifiers here. E is one identifier, M is one identifier, C is another identifier. So we must know which identifier information we are accessing among those three identifiers. So for that purpose, we need only attribute value for the identifiers. Next one is M. So what is M? It is an identifier. So ID comma. So attribute value 1 is already taken. So the next attribute value is 2. Or this can also be written as ID 2. So 2 is the attribute name. Attribute name or attribute value. Next ID is nothing but token name. Next one, C. So what is C? It is also identifiers. It is also, after M we have asterisk here. E is equal to M into. So what is the asterisk? It is a multiplication operator. So here the token is within the angular bracket star. There is no need of attribute value for star. Next one is C. So C is a token. So identifier. So let the attribute value is 3. So what is 3 here? 3 means ID. So the attribute value 3 will provide information about C. Next one is star star. So what is star star? It is an exponential operator. Exponentiation operator. So within the angular brackets we can write star star, or within the angular brackets we can write exponentiation. It is our choice. Next one is constant. It is a number. So there is no need to store that information there. Next one is semicolon. So these are the various lexemes and the corresponding tokens. And what is the next one? Patterns. Patterns are mainly useful to define regular expressions. So in order to define the regular expressions, we use patterns. Let's see the regular expression for an identifier. Identifier is nothing but a variable. In C language, a variable or identifier starts with either a letter. Letter means alphabet. So starts with either a letter or underscore, followed by any number of letters or digits are underscored. So here the rule is very, very simple. Identifier starts with letter or underscore, followed by any number of letters or digits are underscored. Here we can have zero or any occurrences of this combination. So here we can use the symbol star. So star represents zero or more occurrences of this combination. So identifier starts with a letter. It may be either lowercase alphabet or uppercase alphabet or underscore, followed by any number of letters or any number of digits or any number of underscores. Or this can be simplified as letter means small a to z, capital A to z, or some what is the another symbol? Underscore. Next, followed by letter means small a to z, capital A to z, and digit means 0 to 9 underscore. So any combination of this one. So this is about tokens, lexemes and patterns. So next we have one more topic in the role of lexical analysis, that is lexical errors. Lexical errors. So last topic in the role of lexical analyzer. Lexical errors are generated during lexical analyzer process. The commonly generated lexical errors are, the first one is spelling errors. The second one is unmatched string. So third one is appearance of illegal characters. Next, fourth one is exceeding length of identifier. So these are the commonly generated lexical errors which are generated by lexical analyzer. So what is the first one? Spelling errors. Let us assume that we want to write do, but in place of wo I have written I. So this is nothing but a spelling error. And the second one is unmatched string. So let the statement is like this: print of I. Here this is a string, so we have to enclose this string within double quotations. If you don't use double quotations here, then the compiler, the lexical analyzer, will generate an error called unmatched string, because for the corresponding double quotations we must use double quotations here. And the next one is appearance of illegal characters. Let us assume that here print of I is our statement, semicolon, but after the statement I use just two symbols, $2. So those are nothing but some illegal characters, so they are some lexical errors. And the last one is exceeding length of the identifier. If you take C language, then the maximum length of the identifier is approximately 32 characters. If more than 32 characters is specified, then what will happen is a lexical error is generated. So in order to handle these errors, we have several error recovery mechanisms. So let's see what are those error recovery mechanisms. The possible error recovery mechanisms are the first one is delete a single character from the remaining input. Second one is insert a missing character into the remaining input. Next, third one is replace one character by other character. Next one is transpose transpose is nothing but swapping. Transpose two adjacent characters, and the last one is delete successive characters. Delete successive characters from the remaining input, until lexical analyzer recognizes a well-formed token. So these are the various error recovery mechanisms we have. First one is delete a single character from the remaining input. Second one is insert a missing character into the remaining input. Third one is replace one character by other character. Fourth one, transpose two adjacent characters. Fifth one, delete successive characters from the remaining input until lexical analyzer recognizes a well-formed token. Here this approach is called as panic mode error recovery. So panic mode error recovery approach. So let's see the first one. What is the first one? Delete a single character from the remaining input. So let the statement here is D, but actually what is the correct statement we have to write? Do. So what will happen is here we have to delete I. So in place of I we have to write O. So whenever we write O, then the compiler, then the lexical analyzer identifies the correct token, that is a keyword. That is the first approach. What is the second approach? Insert a missing character into the remaining input. Here in place of printf, let us assume that we have written prntf. So now the compiler will generate some error messages. Now we have to correct that error. Insert a missing character into the remaining input. So what is the missing character here? Hi. So we have to insert I into the remaining input so that lexical analyzer will recognize this token, so that error won't be displaced. Next one is replace one character by other character. Here the statement is do, D. But actually what is the correct keyword? Do. So in place of I, we have to replace with O. Next one is transpose two adjacent characters. Here let the statement is like this, rpintf. But actually what is the statement here? Printf. So we have to swap these two characters. So pr. So this is the approach. And what is the last one? Delete successive characters from the remaining input until lexical analyzer recognizes a well-formed token. So this approach is called as panic mode error recovery approach. Let the statement is like this, printf hi $. So we have to delete these successive characters from the remaining input, so that our lexical analyzer will identify the correct token. So this is about the role of lexical analyzer. So in this concept we have to explain about what is the role of lexical analyzer, or what are the functions of lexical analyzer. Next one, the separation of lexical analyzer from the parser. Next one, about tokens, lexemes and patterns. And the last one, lexical errors. So we have to write these four things in this concept, the role of lexical analyzer.